lot of work.
I'd like to invite the panelists up, and then we'll begin. This is on. Again, thank you everyone for coming. I think since the city finally showed up, I'm so excited about this. I'm so excited to see this city. To direct our first question to them, and it really has to do with I think we'll start the first part talking sort of a bit backwards and talk about heritage before we talk about going forward and how it might shape other things. But really would sort of like to ask how you see this thematic framework influencing heritage policy and how it might work, since policy is in the nitty gritty of things and wants to get people to do things, and this is very much their own ideas.
Well, I think that's the great thing that this new way of looking at our heritage will be, that it's going to be easier to ascribe that history and see where we've got gaps, see where we, for example, we can look at now our register, as Don alluded to, and see how many, where everything fits. And a huge percentage of the current heritage register are homes built during the mostly Edwardian era. So, you know, we can just easily tell that we've got a lot of types of resources that aren't on our register. So I think that's one way, is that it's going to give us the ability to then identify those gaps and prioritize them in policy for certain programs, in terms of whether it's incentives or just being identified on our register. The more significant piece, though, is that I think it gives also an information base for a variety of city programs, not just heritage programs and property-based, but neighborhood planning, in terms of what we put forward for new policies, new community plans, new zoning. It's going to inform that. I think that's what we'll be able to use it for. Also, other city departments that may help with commemoration, so arts and cultural grants, street naming, things like that, will be able to use this as a resource to help inform those pieces, because not everything can be added to the register and, you know, protected within heritage revitalization agreements. That's not the best place for us to do some of this work.
That's great, and it certainly will be a move forward. Of course, you did mention Edwardian houses, and you know this 1940 dig is something that makes me a bit upset. And I think that there is a bit of a gap in this whole plan, because I think it was a little bit biased, because it was, post-war is like this little thing, right? And then we can, that I think could have been expanded on things. But I think that, Virginia, I wanted to ask you, because you guys have something that's a little more broad in terms of its inclusion and maybe not so weighted towards this kind of sort of war, and because, you know, after the war, there's like one category where you have to do something more broad. And by the way, you guys should just step in if you want to answer or add to anything, so I'm just not asking every single person a question.
Great. So for those of you in the audience who aren't familiar with the City of New Westminster, and we're implementing, or moving towards implementation anyways, of our first heritage conservation area in that city, and the neighborhood that the community really brought forward into the heritage conservation area process is the Queens Park neighborhood, which is nestled right in behind City Hall, so it's easy for me to get to, which is nice. But what's really unique about that neighborhood, and what the community really identified as being important about that neighborhood, is that there's a mix of housing types and housing eras, and you can almost trace the development of the city, right, from kind of its relationship to the water all the way through and through the post-war era. And so there's infill housing and interesting different pieces. You know, there's some grand estates left, but a lot of those were, for example, in the war converted into rooming houses, and now they operate more like an apartment building. And so there's all these different pieces, and we've been doing a lot of work thinking about how do you capture that diversity, and how do you ensure that the good examples of older houses are protected, just like the good examples of newer houses. So it's something that we're really looking at as part of our conservation area, and I think we don't have a thematic framework yet in New Westminster, but it's definitely approaching that kind of style.
I'm going to take Javier on his comments.
Yeah.
Just by way of explanation, I know in the historic context, there's only eight sort of chapters. And post-war Vancouver is an incredibly complex time period, and it's not meant to downplay that. The way it plays out in the thematic framework is every one of the components and sub-themes goes to the present. So there's no privileging Edwardian era houses. God knows the register is full of them, and banks and churches. And so when we look at, and again, when you see the breakdown in architecture, we go right up into modernism. There is one house, for example, that we've recommended for the register, which is a 1980s postmodern house, which is quite unique. So we're not trying to privilege modern or pre-war over post-war. How that plays out in the long term and in terms of protection, I don't know. But the register, thematic framework, doesn't in any way, shape, or form prevent us recognizing the modern era. As a matter of fact, it moves us into the modern era.
And I want to say it's true, right? And I think that Don's done an amazing job. I just want to get that out there. It's an incredibly large document. I don't want to belittle it, but the fact that, you know, those 75 years get one chapter, and, you know, except for the First Nations part, that's 10,000 years, you know.
They get one chapter.
They get one chapter for 10,000 years, and, you know, then it goes through. But I think that in the language, it is important, and it is important to recognize. I mean, we had that sort of modernism of the 50s that was kind of progressive thing. We had the postmodern, we had these things, and I think to break them down will give them some significance, and that can happen in the future. I think that it is included. I'm just suggesting that it's something that permeates a lot of Vancouver discussion.
I'll tell you a story.
Okay.
In 1985 to 86, when we were working on phase two of the Vancouver Heritage Inventory, there was a very strong push to have a cutoff date of 1918 at the time. And I argued vociferously against that at the time. Because the Marine building was already designated. We had a 1930 building designated already, so how could we have a cutoff date? And I actually, the house that Robert Lemon ultimately bought, the 1936 house, one of the team members left the room because he refused to evaluate it, because it was just not, obviously not heritage. So I think that the other thing is that we're on a you know, there's a continuum there. When we were doing that original inventory, Art Deco was almost unknown or under-recognized. Then we've really understood through the city's recent landmarks program the depth of the buildings that were important in the post-war era. And I think that will be a process we'll continue. I accept the challenge, though, when things like dates get nailed into zoning, and then is how rigid is that? How much does that privilege those buildings over any potentially good later houses is a challenge.
But I think it'll be great because, as you know, another one of my things that I get upset about is the tearing down of the Terry Fox Memorial, you know, that used to be there, not because it was the most amazing building or even I liked it very much, but I think that kind of willful erasure of that period of history because we decided we didn't like it was wrong, and I'm hoping that this document is going to help us to avoid that, where we actually have a matter of taste and say, well, we don't like that anymore, we can tear it down. That's really not fair to our history, right? And I think it'll be kind of just an interesting kind of thing how we may implement this and help us with neighborhoods. And I wanted to ask you about the implementation of UBC. So.
Well, just to follow on this idea of, you know, what we value is static in time. I was surprised when I came to UBC that a Chan Center and the C.K. Choi building are on our list of heritage resources. And both were, you know, Chan was built 25 years ago, and Choi in, I think, the 90s. So, you know, they belong to themes that recognize this idea of innovation and cultural impact. And so the way that our themes are organized are, the themes work across the entire span of history. Really, at any, you know, any given time period, they work.
And you're finding that's helping you preserve certain things that you've seen?
It's helping us, I think, understand what we value, and you know, making sure that we are keeping you know, aspects of all of our, you know, fabric, and really understanding what's behind what we value.
I want to ask Helen, because you worked on this in Victoria, about kind of taking that kind of idea that Joanne is talking about and implementing it in a city or certain areas of the city, and to discuss that.
Right, so Victoria has a citywide thematic framework that was finished 7 years ago. In some ways, it's nowhere near as progressive as UBC or Vancouver in that it does definitely recognize mid-century, but it doesn't come all the way up to the future, so that is something that should be revised at some point in the future. It is very useful, though. As Tanis was saying, it can be used to identify all kinds of gaps, and it can be used to provide overall direction. Anytime you want to do a placemaking activity with engineering or cultural planning, for example, where you want to talk about community identity in a visual way. So examples of that are engineering works. Everybody knows, I think, or has seen simple things like the BC Hydro utility boxes. Those wraps are usually designed by city staff. Manhole covers, BIA banners, really simple things. And then much more significant or large pieces of public art. From one perspective, the Stan Douglas piece right here is an example of something that would be the implementation of a heritage theme. It shows a particular moment in history, but it also says something about the place we are, where we are here today. It's an image of a social protest that happened in the 1970s, but it also signifies a lot about community identity in this this part of Vancouver, right here and right now. So I see it as something that is very useful for placemaking. And by that I mean any kind of urban design work where you're working in historic parts of the city, which realistically is anywhere in the city. And also, as Tana started to talk about, cultural planning. So we use our cultural spaces and all kinds of activities happen in them. When you have identified something like Chinese-Canadian identity is important to a city, then you have a way of maybe saying, well, maybe we should fund traditional games in public space in Chinatown. Or I used to live in Grandview Woodland. The bowl green in the main park in Grandview Woodland was revitalized largely so Italian seniors could continue to play a traditional game. So there's a lot of different ways that themes help to shape the city.
Yeah, I think that's great. It's really inspiring, looking forward to seeing those things happen, which is great. Maybe a little part that'll our friend Gordon Price would like as we get into the nitty-gritty of things. Like, how does it inform the actual things? I know that you've had some issues in the West with people wanting answers to things. I mean, this is ideas, and it's very evaluative, and it has a process to go in. And somebody that wants to do something wants to come in and say, hey, yes or no?
Yeah.
Right, and maybe you can expand on what you've been finding with that.
Definitely. That's great. I think, for me, I'm going to be the person here who talks a little bit about the limitations of this, just from the perspective of implementation. As we can see from the work that Don's done, it is a lot of work to do this kind of research. And as Don highlighted, that there's, you know, LA did a great plan, but they have a lot of money backing them as well. And so it's a lot of time and research and analysis. And often it involves looking at things on a case-by-case basis or finding those really great examples that speak to the themes. And so in my kind of limited experience in the past little while, there's been a lot of discussion. And that's part of the public education piece as I see it, is that lots of people come in and the first question they ask is it heritage, yes or no? Can I take it down, yes or no? Like that's the question. Well, you know, is it because of the date? It's asking for that evaluative criteria. And so I do see thematic frameworks helping to build that kind of tool and helping to educate people to say, well, these are all the different ways we identify heritage in a city and in a community. And, you know, that it helps integrate those things that are intangible with the tangible and saying, well, there's all these pieces to the puzzle that come together and we need to understand them before we just move forward and say, oh yeah, okay, it's 1939, so save it, it's 1941, so don't. And that's kind of the pervasive attitude that I'm running into a lot.
I'm going to jump in because I know that Dawn knows that I have a love for value-based evaluation criteria. I mean, I see it as nothing but a good thing, but it is only one tool. What it does is provide you the themes that we all work with when we write statements of significance, for example. But the sister piece is making sure that you have value-based evaluation criteria in order to rank what you decide to prioritize, whether by putting them on the register or protecting individual sites or protecting areas. So the thematic framework itself doesn't do that. You need a different tool. You need evaluation criteria. Maybe Dawn.
Absolutely. So that's part of the package that we're putting together as well, and we've really been struggling with it, I assure you, and trying to move from the existing numerical system for evaluation, but keep the kind of evaluative tools and wording. You know, in 1986, that was state of the art, was that numerical system, and now we would never propose something like that. But you still have to have tools to evaluate. And so part of that, to me, is the moving towards a system whereby you're identifying the values very clearly as to whether they're citywide or neighborhood-wide or maybe not that significant, and then also beginning to look at comparisons. So one of the things that's really important within that evaluation is how do things compare? And is this more significant than that? Is this better design than its significance is based on architecture, is it better than this? If it's significant, it's based on community history, is it more significant? So you still have to make decisions, is the problem, because we aren't going to save everything. And I have an example, actually, and it's one of the things that I found that was, I grew up in Vancouver. Certain things surprised me, because I had no idea either of their existence or their significance, and that, to me, was very informative. One of the things that I found when we started really digging into the sports history was of the existence of a surprising number of lawn bowling clubs that have been in existence since, you know, 100 years. And there's one on the register, there's seven or eight not on the register, and these carefully tended little cultural landscapes that are perfect. I mean, these people labor over these things, and they're all on city land, by the way. Are really treasured and valued by the people who play that sport. The interesting thing is we just finally said, here they all are. We didn't try and evaluate them at this point in time because we resolutely refused to identify something based on whether it would survive or not. We didn't tie it to conservation, we tied it to just identification of value. And the interesting example that Helen brought up, the Granby Woodlands Bocce Courts, were actually a lawn bowling green that was destroyed one year by weather. And it was decided to put it back to suit the community, to, you know, give a different type of recreation to the community. But it's the same thing, it's all lawn bowling, right? So it's an interesting challenge, I think, moving forward. You can identify these sites, but you still have to find, and the park board could close down every one of those lawn bowling clubs tomorrow because they're on city land. Would people scream and yell and say, don't do that, probably. But you realize that we have certain things that are under our control in the public sector and certain things that the private sector controls. So that was another something that we thought about, but again, didn't tie identification to that.
So Donald would have lawn bowling applications open for everybody to join, right. So they don't disappear.
Join, they're all getting old.
I think this is really interesting, and I want to get back to you on this, because there's a couple of themes that have come in here, which is, you know, I go and yell at you and tell you all these things, but I know that if I was in your position, I want a stamp that says yes, no, 1940, because it would make my job very easy instead of having to go through 139 sub-themes, whatever, you know, this exponential amount of work, right? So really it's going to be how you're going to, ideas about implementing, whether it's going to be at the neighborhood scale, neighborhood plans, and an overall city plan that Vancouver may one day have, I don't know, you know, how you see that kind of shaping out, but really also getting to kind of public engagement, right? Because the public that kind of has to understand this. We may have this big home that we'd refer to, and this is arcade, you know, like, and then everybody else, like, what are you doing? Like, they don't actually understand. So how's the city looking at engaging the public, or letting the public engage?
So we are, that's a great question, because we are going to be launching the process to engage on this draft thematic framework. It's not set in stone. It's something that we want people to be able to see, to look at, and then understand what it means going forward. So that question is something people will say, well, so what? What is this? So there's two thoughts I have. One is, it isn't a piece that's ever just finished and there it is. I think that's how it gets maintained and updated going on, you know, with our ability to digitize things now, how does this information become something that people can quickly access and drive down to the things that interest them and then contribute to it, is something that I think we can think about. You know, we won't just like the answers right away, but how do we want to be able to support community involvement in building the thematic framework? And I think that's a big piece, because Dawn has done an immense amount of research and has had lots of support. There's been a lot of minds to this, but it's not everything. So it's not going to be the full story on any one particular community or demand to accommodate more growth in housing and density and change in neighborhoods. How do we let neighborhoods evolve? And I think part of just having this as an information base to look back on, to reflect, can inform. It doesn't set the values. I think it talks about what's valuable or what's there, but it doesn't say this is valuable and has to stay. And I think that's where community dialogue and planning process over time will help make that happen at the neighborhood and then eventually citywide level to a certain degree.
I have one quick comment, which was that I'm an old white guy, right? Like, I have a point of view, right? And so what I found really, really challenging in the work is, like, we can begin to do this intellectually, but I'm not speaking for the First Nations. I'm not speaking for the Jewish community. You know, we have to write something, we have to put something there, we have to put a placeholder in. I think this is just the beginning. Absolutely, Tanis, it is not a done thing never to be looked at again. It's armature, I think, is the right word, that you can plug all those pieces in. It was a very personal piece of work for me, having grown up in Vancouver, too, that you're trying to understand, well, that was my point of view of the city, but there was infinite other points of view going on at the same time. This is challenging, and so we could have used a heck of a lot more community input. We could have used a lot more points of view than we had a chance to incorporate. So is it right? Is it wrong? I think it's a starting point. And there were several sections I had so much trouble writing, and just over and over again had to just retool and rethink to even get the categories right. And so the first draft that we handed out was a complete mess. And ultimately, I think we got to the point where we boiled it down. How do you describe, however, the identity of the city? What does that even mean when there's hundreds of thousands of voices and people and communities and things going on? The complexity of it is staggering. But what it comes down to me, was that there was a layering. There was, you know, there were things that were important to the Jewish community that you could outline. There were things that were important to the gay community you could outline. There were things that were important to different cultures. And begin to understand the city as something that is so rich and layered and deep that you can keep digging through it. And that was kind of where we ended up in trying to outline that material. Very challenging.
Yeah, I can imagine it's a very deep. So, Helen, what would you say about in engaging the communities in the neighborhood, because it was more of a neighborhood plan kind of thing going on in Victoria, right?
Yeah, so I left Victoria before I had a chance to do this, but what the game plan was to then, with each update of community plans, which was about to start happening because most of the plans were done in the 1980s, I was using it to not only identify gaps in the register, which is pretty obvious, but to talk, to encourage people to tell us when, well, first of all, is this speaking to you, but I won't talk about the process that was used to develop the framework. There was definitely some
bottom-up involvement with community associations in the neighborhoods. But in doing the actual community plans, Victoria is a highly, highly engaged place. So it's a place where people will have are very vocal about what matters to them. So if it's a streetscape, or there are a huge amount of rocks in Victoria. So the idea was to use the themes for community planning, not only for conservation, strictly speaking, but for urban design in each neighborhood. And as Tanis mentioned in our pre-discussion, for things like zoning overhauls. But I mean, most people wouldn't get very excited about zoning overhauls in Victoria, but they do get very excited about urban design and doing things like cultural mapping and going in and all those kinds of things. So if you have a set of themes, then you can workshop it and go out and do things like mapping.
I think it's good that you pointed this way forward, because I want to ask Joanne, I mean, you've been using it, I mean, UBC has grown by leaps and bounds, and you have this framework that you're using as a framework to go forward.
Yes, it was developed for the 2010 campus plan, like Tanis and Helen are talking about it, it actually informs a lot more than just how we manage our heritage resources. It has informed the transformation of the campus from an auto-oriented campus to a pedestrianized campus. So the bones of the campus have really been maintained and are cherished from the 1914 plan, and so much has changed in terms of the building fabric. But the main mall and the axes and the preservation of those bones is really intrinsic to how the campus public realm in a big way has transformed over the past decade. Even in architecture and new buildings and the restoration of older buildings like the Buchanan Block and the courtyard of the Buchanan Block, one of the really huge, hugely successful projects, have really benefited from this framework it values a lot about the activities and the culture and the social life of spaces more equally to the physical artifacts of the space.
So it's great. I mean, we hear now that this sort of cultural heritage or cultural practices are being done, and I know that you mentioned how we're going to move our neighborhood forward and how we deal with this public space. And do you see it helping you shape that discussion, this framework, on with what we went through with the character home review, as you know, that we're going through,
yes,
and these kind of discussions and the missing middle and affordability and how it might influence that and maybe help you or hinder you?
Exactly. I can't see how this would hinder anything. I think this is the thematic framework is just a way for us to look at things from the past. What then needs to happen is us to discuss and find how either those things can be adapted and included as we move forward, or changed, and we just commemorate them. So in some cases, things in the thematic framework, commemoration is the only option because there is nothing there. For other things, there will be buildings, other installations or infrastructure that is there that we may lose, but we've acknowledged why it was there, how it got to be there, and that it's time for something else to happen. So I think these are going to be the hard conversations that planning always will have to have, and particularly in Vancouver, where we've seen so much change, and that when you look at the thematic framework, the city has always had a lot of change happen really quickly, even from the boom days, the city built up really quickly, and it's changing quickly now. And we'll need to think back, it's not going to be just, wow, that building is of this age, so we have to keep it. It will be, what else is what things need to be happening, where should those be happening, and then are there ways for significant resources to be retained and include that or not? And it's going to be an ongoing conversation. So I think this will be helpful for that, for sure. In terms of the answers, that's going to be, there's so many factors, and this is one of the components. I only hope that this and the acknowledgement and understanding of say, what this could help tell us about our neighborhoods and their character is something that is included in those discussions going forward. And I think this gives us strong footing to do that. There's a chance, without acknowledging our past and having this tool, that in say, for example, a time of housing crisis, that you just, we're going to lose it all, we're changing everything, we're not, it's time to move on. But if we can have this at least part of the conversation, then maybe some important, there's different options that can be looked at and include, be inclusive of retention of some degree of that past and adaptation going forward. You know, whether or not this is a tool to revisit all of our current zoning, rewrite all of our two family dwelling districts, you know, we'll see how that goes. Is that the priority for this right now? I think we will have to talk about that. And I think that's a bigger conversation. That's more than a conversation about what is the thematic framework. It's a conversation about how is the city going to evolve. This will then become one of those core reference documents for people working on that to understand. But there's so much more that needs to be considered.
Well, Tanis has never said such sweet things to me. and I think on that, maybe just Greg, which I think is fantastic, because it's hopefully will help us to both preserve things and move forward.